God. That's the difference. You see that? Joseph's brother never confessed their sin. They never really repented. Or even though they felt sorry, they feel like, oh man. But they never spoke it out to Joseph, never expressed anything to Joseph about that. And that's the reason why guilt rised up again. Let me ask you this. How did you come to the Lord Jesus Christ in your life? Was it just you want to add Jesus into the collections of your idols to make Jesus to be another one? And then once in a while you shake it and then Jesus come up and said, oh, hey, Jesus. And the other one went, oh, there's another one coming, hey, and then all that. Is that what your life is like? James, in his letter, he said that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Let not that man ask of anything from God, the Bible says, because he will not receive anything from God. A man that only had adding Jesus and the God into your life will not be stable in all things that he does. Only those who come to God in repentance and give their life completely to the Lord, surrender their life as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, that's the life that will be changed. That's the life that will see God and taste that He is good. So then, verse 16, his brother sent two people, somebody there, most likely is Benjamin, because Benjamin was the one that had no beef with Joseph, or maybe Judah, because Judah became the leader now in the pack. However, this representation came and it says, before your father died, verse 16, he commanded, saying, thus you shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please forgive the trespass of your brothers and their sin, for they did evil to you. This is Jacob teaching the 10 older sons. That says, listen, this is what you need to say to Joseph. Ask him for forgiveness. Confess your sin to him. And then, the next part of that verse, verse 17, it says, now, this is the brothers, now, please forgive the trespass of your servants of the God of your fathers, of your father. Notice in there is a change of tone now. It says, please forgive us our trespasses. And then not just my trespasses, but the trespasses of the servant of the God of your father. In other words, that these brothers have given their all as servants of God. They have humbled themselves before they came to Joseph and they asked Joseph to forgive them. That's important. This is an important part of that. The goodness of God can only be seen and tasted by those who have submitted, given themselves to God as his servant. Imagine this, just an illustration. If there is a kingdom and there is a king, and you know that you're a beggar, you have no chance whatsoever to be in the palace or even to be near the king. But one day the king came to the marketplace, to the common area, and then he saw you as a beggar, and then he had passion upon you and he says, listen, I have compassion for you, won't you come to my palace? You can eat at my table. Oh, from eating on the scraps, now you're eating on the table. So the king pretty much adopted you, and you come to the king's table and you ate with him. It's great, isn't it? But imagine this, all right, when you come to the king's table, what would you be? I mean, how would you come to the king's? Would you just like, hey, king, what's up? You know, it's a good place, eh? Nothing compared to what I used to have. Oh, really? You can't do that. You come to the king, you humbly before the king, says, king, I will be forever grateful, and whatever you require of me, I will do. I'm your humble servant. You know, when we come before God, you cannot come to God and say, like, hey, God, how's it going? And by the way, you know what I used to have? Oh, it's much better than what I have here. Whoa! There are too many people have that kind of attitude toward God. And let me tell you this, those kind of people cannot and will not be blessed. God only can bless those who are humble. Those who humbly submit to God for whatever it is that's required of God. There are many times there are certain things that God required of us to get rid of. And maybe it has nothing to do with, nothing to do, doesn't offend me or anybody, but then God required us to give up, and guess what? Do it. Because we are God's humble servant. And when we are God's humble servant, God's going to do everything that He pleases in our life, and that's when we are starting to see and to taste that the Lord is good. The servant will taste that in the king's table. And then after hearing these words, the confession of his brothers, notice what happened to Joseph. The Bible says Joseph wept when they spoke to him. The Bible does not give specifically why he wept, for what reason, whether because the brother just confessed. But one thing I noticed in if you read the whole context of that, Joseph, and later on as what he said in verse 20, we can summarize the reasoning of his weeping, because that there is, Joseph meant already all of this, like, that's okay, brother. Remember that earlier in verse, I think it's chapter 48 or 46, when Joseph told his brothers, like, everything that you did is all for good. This is God's provision. God brought you here. You did not send me here to Egypt, but God did. Remember that? And yet here, these guys, this brother says, like, no, we're the one that did it. We did this to you. We did harm to you. Where Joseph says, no, that is not evil. What you think it was evil, no, it's not. So then here it is, in the next three verses, from verse 19 to verse 21. There are three things that Joseph revealed, that God revealed through Joseph, about the goodness of God. What is that God's goodness revealed? Now take a note of this. If you want to know whether this is God's goodness or not in your life, look at these three things. Number one, God's goodness revealed holiness. God's goodness, first and most of all, revealed His holiness. If what you have, if you receive something and you think that, oh, this is from God, but it does not reveal God's holiness, let me tell you this, it's not from God. It's not from God. Be careful when you label everything and says, oh, God is good. But actually what you receive does not bring God's holiness, does not reveal that. Look at what it says in verse 19. Joseph said to the brothers, do not be afraid, for am I in the place of God? Wow. Guys, next time before you get angry, make sure you remember this verse. Am I in the place of God to judge you, to condemn you, to do anything? Am I in the place of God? And you know what? So many times, if we are not careful, we can play God. Do you know that? On somebody else's life. Usually the wealthiest one or the most intellectual one, the one that like to play God. True? Yes. That's why there are many people that are so-called in the higher level of life, so to speak, they have a God complex. You know what I mean? If anybody else getting closer to them, they're like, oh, thou shalt not. God forbid. Who's God? Me. I'm the God. I don't want you to be. Have you ever met people like that? Don't raise your hand. Don't be afraid, he said. Am I in the place of God? God is the one who does all things. God's the one that makes everything. This is God who also has the divine justice. God is the one that does everything. He is God, and I am not God, what Joseph said. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 15, it says, see that no one render evil for evil to anyone. Did you hear that? No one render evil for evil to anyone. So if somebody do evil to you, don't pay back with evil. It says, but always pursue what is good both for yourself and for all. That's why in the New Testament, Lord Jesus Christ says that if someone slapped you on one cheek, give them the other one. Why is it? Why do not render evil with evil, Christians? Here's the reason why. Because every good thing comes from God. Everything that comes from God is always good. Do you hear me? If you're God's people, then everything that comes from you should be good, not evil. Christians will not do like this, like, I cannot wait to give this payback to you. one day when I'm up there, I'm gonna let you know how I feel right now. Have you ever had that before? I think that's the reason why you laugh, right? Number two, God's goodness reveal his providence. God's goodness reveal his providence. In verse 20, but as for you, I love this verse. If you can memorize it, it's also awesome. It says, but as for you, you meant evil against me. But, here it is, but God meant it for what? For good. Wait a minute, God. When you allow Joseph to be sold to the slavery, that was good? Come on, be real, God. To be a slave, and then after that, to be accused as a rapist, and then putting me in prison, that was good? Remind me of this illustration, the story I heard a long time ago from a pastor. He was talking about this king who had an advisor, and his advisor is a very positive advisor. Everything he said is always, there's the word good. Oh, it's good. Oh, it's good. So one day, the king went hunting with this advisor. And then when hunting, the king pulled the bow and he saw the deer. And then he jammed his finger into the snare of the bow, and then he snapped that bow, and then he cut his thumb off. And then when he cut his thumb off, he was like, ah, you know, he was in pain. And then his advisor says, that's good, that's good. The king was angry. He's like, wow, you know. And then, of course, in his anger, the king sent his advisor into prison. Weeks later, the advisor is still in prison. The advisor still thinks it's good. So one day, king went to hunt again without a thumb. And this time, he went up there and then he separated himself from the crowd of his bodyguards. And then he was about to shoot a deer. And then suddenly, he found there was a group of tribal men. And that tribal man came along to him and arrested him, brought him to the village. And when the villagers over there about to do something to him, cook him or something that way, and then he saw that the king has no thumb. They thought that the king had a disease. So immediately they kicked the king out of the village and said, get out of here! You're bringing sickness and disease into this village. On the way back, the king riding a horse, back and meet with the bodyguards. On the way back, the king thought, it is good that I didn't have my thumb. If I were to have my thumb, then I would lose my life. So then he went to the prison and he told the advisor and he says, listen, I am so sorry that I have to put you in prison. And the advisor says, no, king, it was good. No, it's not good. You're in prison. He said, king, if you didn't put me in prison, I would have went with you. Then they will eat me and they will kick you out. And I'll be dead. So it is good. It is good. As funny as that story is, the truth is that the Bible says that all things work together. But I want to read you that whole thing of Romans 8. Let's look at Romans 8 in verse 26. Let's begin from verse 26. Look at your Bible. I only have verse 27 and 28 as the focus of it, but let's read it from verse 26 in your Bible. Romans chapter 8, verse 26, if you would please. The scripture says this, likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses. Okay? In our weaknesses. Not in our strength, in our weaknesses. Why is it important that the Spirit help us in our weaknesses, not in our strength? Because here it is. For we do not know what we should pray for as we ought to. But the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. Meaning that the Holy Spirit can pray on our behalf for something that we cannot even speak of. We cannot express it to God. But the Holy Spirit knew and he will pray on our behalf. And then he said this, now he who searches the hearts knows the mind of the Spirit is. God knows the mind of the Spirit is because he makes intercession for the saints according to whose will? The will of God. Every time we make prayer to God, it must be according to the will of God. Otherwise, it will not go to the throne of God. God will not approve it. God will not allow it. in his presence. And then here it is. This is the popular verse. And we know that all things work together for good to those who what? Who love God and who are the called according to his purpose. You see, God's goodness, he is good, but can only be experienced by those who knows him, who have personal relationship with him, meaning that he is your God. There's no one else above him. And then that for those who are the call to do his will. You see, so many people think like, oh, I want God's goodness. I want this from God. I want God to bless me with this and bless me with that. All of the lists are given. And yet they don't even have personal relationship with God. They don't even serve God. And they demand things from God. How fair is that? Would you like me to come to your house and just say, like, I want this. Here's the list. Would you please give me everything that I have in here, please? We do nothing for you, nothing in return, just give it to me. Would you do that for me? Would you give it? I don't think you'll do that, would you? Be careful how we look at God's goodness. But here's the promise that all things, everything, the good, the bad, the ugly, all things work together for good. You guys that have children, you know how it is, right? We like to protect our children, to give them all the good things, correct? We don't want them to get hurt, right? But there are times in our life when we have to let them just to experience that hurtfulness, a little bit pain. How many of you have a 16-year-old right now or a teenager and you're still cutting their steaks for you? Anybody? Or feeding them in the spoon like, eat? Anybody like that? No. Oh, it's painful, isn't it, to bring the plate and a spoon from the table to their mouth? You know? No. Learn all of that. It's not easy. Remember how many times they make accidents and things like that. You know, God, when he sees us, he's not just letting all sorts of good things according to our will. That's what God gives. But there are times when God allows things that are bad, like Jacob. Remember that? How horrible that he experienced, that he lost everything that